So we wanted Johnny's death not to be in vain. And he's kind of become the poster child now for a rabies prevention campaign through the Alliance for Rabies Control as part of the World Rabies Day Initiative. And you can see here on this flyer, it's this easy to pick up rabies. That's Johnny with one of our technicians. So he's now educating people to prevent this. And there are three areas we're going to touch on very briefly: vaccination, bite confinement, and exposure confinement. This is a graph courtesy of the CDC. If you look, the overall cases of rabies in the United States have increased in the last 50 years. However, the number of cases in domestic animals has decreased and stayed relatively low. If you look at where the cases are reported in the United States, they're clustered around where the vectors are. If you go back to our graph, we mentioned that the number of wild animal cases are increasing. We're encroaching on their environment. We're building in new areas. People are coming in contact with them. In 1947, there were almost 7,000 cases of dog rabies in the United States. In 2006, there were 71 cases. Johnny was one of those. This is a result of mandatory vaccination laws that have prevented the spread of rabies from dog to dog.
It has been demonstrated that if you vaccinate 70% of the dog population, that you can reduce the incidence of human rabies to zero. That has to do with the concept of herd immunity, where you don't have to vaccinate every single animal, but just enough to protect the people in the community.
Here's some very compelling data from Mexico that shows as the number of dogs vaccinated every year increased, the incidence of canine rabies decreased to a much lower level. But more importantly, if you look at the incidence of human rabies when compared to the number of dogs vaccinated, you see that the number of human cases has dropped virtually to zero in Mexico as a result of mandatory dog vaccination programs. This is very compelling evidence that they do indeed work.
Any healthy dog, cat, or ferret that bites a person has to be quarantined for a 10-day period. And this has to do with the research that was done in development of the vaccine for these species, and that's the only ones that can be quarantined for the 10-day period. Of course, a bite's only considered a bite if it breaks the skin. And then, if you look at a difference, exposure confinement, that's an animal that is exposed to a rabid animal that must be euthanized immediately if it's unvaccinated, and if they're unwilling to have the animal euthanized, then the animal can be quarantined for a 6-month period. I have to say, in our state and most readily in our county, we prefer not to have to do a 6-month quarantine. If we know that an animal is definitely exposed to a rabid animal, then recommendation is to destroy the pet. That's why it's so important to keep that current rabies vaccination. And that is the difference between exposure confinement versus the bite confinement. So if you have an animal that's currently vaccinated, if you rebooster the animal, then it has to be done within the 72-hour period, then the animal is considered immune. But if they're not vaccinated, rebooster it within that 72-hour period, even though they have a current vaccination, they're considered unvaccinated and handled the same way that an unvaccinated animal is.
So here we have Johnny, and we've tried to take his death and spin it into something positive. And hopefully we can all work together to make rabies history.
Thank you so much for sharing this case about Johnny.
It's been a pleasure. Thanks for having us.
Thank you.